Hello and welcome to Position 6, the Dota 2 podcast, in which I, Daniel Offen, aka Mr. Big Jams, get to know some of the most important and exciting people in the Dota 2 scene. This week's episode is with iAnnihilate. iAnnihilate recently achieved an impressive second place finish at Dream League with Demon Slayers after going through some major personal issues which are touched on in this podcast, but I won't outline now. I think this is a really great episode and slightly different change in pace to what I normally do, so I hope you enjoy listening to it as much as I enjoyed recording it. If you'd like to talk about the episode while you're listening to it, you can join the Position 6 Discord channel, which will be listed in the episode description, or you can follow me on Twitter, at Daniel Offen, and that's spelled Daniel and then O-F-F-E-N. And please do let me know there if you've got any feedback or comments. If you'd like to financially support the show because you think it's worth paying for, you can find a link to my Patreon in the episode description. And the episode will kick off right now. So talk me through where you are at the moment. Is Demon Slayer still together as a team?
We're still in talks with each other about it, but it's pretty up in the air whether or not we're staying together. It's not that we don't want to stay together. It's just usually in these type of periods, everyone's getting offers from everywhere else. And, you know, we're not bound by a sponsor or anything. So if people see like a really nice offer on the table, everyone kind of has the like understanding that if your teammate gets a good offer, there's like, there's no bad blood or anything, you know, like that's just how it goes. But ideally we would stick together and play the next qualifiers. It's just depending on how the dominoes fall, basically.
Is that always the problem with stacks like the ones like Demon Slayers or any NA stacks, that they're somewhat tenuous because people can always get a better offer?
I think it's not so much even always about like money, like it is for some of the players on our team, because like, you know, including myself, like I live basically on my own now, so you know, there's rent and bills and whatnot. So if a team were to like offer me salary, then they automatically have a leg up or something. But sometimes like players just also don't want to play based in NA. Like even a lot of the top NA teams try to boot camp in other regions. So there's all these other factors that go into it, and it is kind of a problem for tier two NA teams and tier 3 NA teams, because the scene's not that big here. We have probably the smallest scene out of all of the regions. Like, we do have some good players and some good teams, but in terms of volume, so it can be a problem just for stability-wise that, like, you know, you get a nice offer to go play in the EU or maybe Southeast Asia. A couple players went a few times, you know. It just kind of is what it is. It's just the nature of the beast.
If the bigger teams don't boot camp in North America, does it make quite difficult to be a stack in North America if there's no serious large teams to scrim against?
There's always a few, but it really depends, because like, I think it does make it harder for the tier two teams in general, but the boot camping stuff really only happens once the qualifiers are over. Like, before qualifiers, everyone's kind of playing each other. Maybe like the super top teams only play each other. And then you get like an opportunity. Like my stacks usually have an opportunity to play against some of the bigger stacks every now and then. Like, but generally they try to schedule against the actual good teams, maybe in the other group or something just before the qualifiers. Or sometimes the groups aren't released that early, so they just play each other all the time. But it's more so like during these downtime periods where there really isn't much going on tournament-wise, so no one's playing. Like, we don't really practice against anyone, and then the big teams that have qualified for the major typically will go boot camp where the major is, like, a month before it or something. I think a couple of the NA teams boot camped in China before the last major for, like, a month. So, like, even during the time where you might have the opportunity to practice against some of these teams before these big tournaments, and then the qualifiers are right after, there's really just no one to really play against besides, you know, the other stacks. So it's not necessarily, like, I think you can make it work. You don't need the best practice partners to become a really good team. I have, like, really strong opinion about that. I've seen in other games and other disciplines where, like, it's really about how much work you can put in on your own outside of these like couple games a day that you might get against a really top team where you might get crushed anyway. Like the amount of catching up a lot of the players and teams have to do is outside of those games anyway. So I don't think it's like a huge problem, but it definitely doesn't help.
I can imagine as well, if after qualifying, every team that qualified ahead of Demon Slayers in the NA qualifiers for the major were all at events. So would they be more in tune with the meta and you have to kind of adapt more quickly, or is that not a problem?
When we had our run at Dream League where we got second, we had like almost zero preparation for the event. I came in as like a last minute stand-in, and almost all the preparation we did during the tournament, we had the day of grace, basically, where on the first day we lost all our games almost, or we might have just lost them all. I don't even remember anymore. But those games didn't, like, we just went to the loser's bracket. We didn't get kicked out of the whole tournament. And we were able to, like, develop our own style based on the meta that was going on. Like, I helped our captain, Juan, out a lot with, you know, what I think we should pick and what I think the other teams have been picking. And we kind of found our groove that way. So I think a lot of these things, like, they do happen at events, but even if you're not at the event, you can see the meta unfolding if you pay like enough attention to it and you really skim through the drafts. I think probably a lot of players out there would admit that they just watch a lot of the games live. They don't even go over most of the replays, or if they do, they don't really pay attention to the draft that much. They're just looking at their role. So there's enough out there for teams to make it work. I think it's just, you know, when you're putting like the do or die tournament setting, it can help a lot to gain some experience that way and stuff like that.
Is it very different playing in the environment rather than watching it from the outside, do you find? Or can you pick up and learn pretty much the same things?
I think from my experience, I've had a lot of experience sitting at home watching the other teams and other players, like even on my friends' list play. I think it can actually be like more of like a positive mindset when you're not there. Like, it does suck that you're not there, but you don't have all these other like outward pressures onto you to like perform. Like, you know, maybe your teammates having like a really bad tournament or something, you're not necessarily toxic about it, but you like, you know, it's not going well. You know, there could be friction between teammates and stuff. Like, all these other pressures probably make it harder to get a real like good learn out of it. But if you're just watching like the best team in the world and they're doing this one strategy or something, or like they really define the meta, I feel like you can pick that apart much easier. Maybe you don't completely understand how they came up with it or where they're coming from with it, but it's much easier to copy than to invent. So I think the biggest difference between playing at the event and being at home is you actually have less time than you think at the event to prepare for stuff. Most of the time we spend at the event is like traveling to and from the venue. You know, there's media day. There isn't much time to play between games. You have to be ready before the last game's over. So like if it's a best of three, you have to be ready during game two. So like you can't really, like you can talk a lot about what's going on, but most of the time you're just sitting there watching the game live. You're not really doing all that much. Like, you are quite busy when you're at the event, so.
You mentioned that a lot of the people from Demon Slayers have other offers to consider or other avenues to go down if the team breaks up. Are there things like that in the fire for you, or are you staking a lot on the team sticking together?
Right now, since I had to go through a lot of stuff like personally, like even the last qualifiers, I had almost zero time to play, and it really showed not only in like my own gameplay, but I think I had like a decent role in the team as like kind of like a secondary leader in the team. So when I didn't know what was going on in the patch, it really, I think, affected the way everyone else was playing. Like, I think I have a really important role in the team personally. So I think the whole team suffered because of it, and, you know, it sucks, but I haven't really been focusing too much on, you know, where I'm going to be playing, or I'm just kind of taking this like moving and basically a whole month that's just get my stuff sorted together. And then in the new year, I'll be looking at, you know, maybe playing on a different team if our team doesn't work out or whatnot. But there's not really like some big offer I have, or I'm not really like searching for anything either right now either. So I've had people come and talk to me about, you know, if my team doesn't work out, we can make a stack here and there, but not like these like tier one or tier two like sponsor teams or anything, nothing like big like that. So
do you think it would be relatively simple to slot back into the scene? Because as I understand, you have had a lot of personal stuff happen that's probably stopped your development somewhat, but I know there are a lot of players who were in that situation, like Snaking, for example, who took 3 or 4 years away from the scene and then came back very strong. Do you feel quite confident that you're going to be able to do that?
This isn't the first time I've had to take a break away from the scene and like kind of slot back in. I think it was really hard the first time I took a break because I was much younger, and when I started playing again, there was more of like an ego thing. Like, you know, you think you're better than you are, and the game always progresses and stuff. So you can like think you're better than you are and then not. But me personally, I feel like I have a pretty good understanding of myself and what I can do as a player and like where my potential lies. So regardless of like whether I think I can slot in or not, I have a lot of faith in my ability to play the game or learn the game, even if I fall behind. So I think it wouldn't be too hard to, you know, get better if I need to or find a team here and there. I think personally, what I've learned the most over the last few years while I was dealing with like my mom going through cancer treatments and stuff is like, it is really hard, no matter how hard you try, to have like a positive mentality. And like, I think it's really important to have all of your like stuff in order, like when it comes to even just health or, you know, mental well-being, to really like be motivated and keep going and really searching for the word here. Just basically to keep like a positive mental attitude about everything, mm-hmm. like as overused as that term is, and to like give it your 100% focus. Whereas like, you know, the past couple months, like the month where we went to Dream League, I didn't play at all like the month before, but then I started playing a lot like a couple weeks before the tournament. And I didn't really have any financial burdens or responsibilities at the time. Like we had the last month's rent paid where we were living. So I really didn't have to do anything but play Dota. And, you know, I think it was night and day from the last like couple of years even to like just the couple weeks leading up to that tournament and how much effort I could put in and how much I could like really show as a player what I have to offer. I think I performed probably the best in my whole career during that tournament. And, you know, it's like one thing, like I love my mom to death, but like it isn't like that she was like a burden the whole time. Like I would do it all over again. I think supporting your family and your loved ones is more important than anything else. But being able to have uninterrupted focus and like 100% dedication in something is really important. And I think I'll have that moving forward, which will be quite an asset. I have had time to grieve and everything about my situation and not necessarily get over it, but like cope. So I don't think it'll really impede like me going forward, basically.
And often what people say about those situations and the grieving process is having something to pour yourself into a little bit and focus on will be somewhat helpful, I think, for your personal life as well as professional life. Would you agree with that as an idea?
When my mom first got cancer in about January 2017, like it's almost been 3 years now, I think I was able over the past couple of years to like put my effort into Dota and distract myself from it. But every now and then you just like stuff just happens where, you know, it just gets hard. It's like over such a long process. Like, I don't know how it is to lose a loved one immediately, like from a car accident or something like that. I've never been through that process, so I really don't know what that's like, but it really felt like a really slow, like it's almost like every like couple days or every week there would just be like another needle like just plunged into you, and you're like, oh, that kind of hurts, and then it just builds up over time. Like bringing her to like chemo treatments and then seeing what that does to her, like I don't know, there would just be periods of time where like, yeah, I could get lost in Dota and really focused for a couple weeks here and there, but it's really difficult even if you're trying to find something else to like put your time into to really get down to brass tacks and focus on it. You're just going to get constantly distracted if you're going through something. I tried my best. I'm a really positive person in general, and I'm really, like, I'd say, you know, I have a good work ethic. I can be lazy sometimes about certain things that I, like, don't want to do. But when it comes to, like, the stuff I actually, like, enjoy or am passionate about, I usually give, like, my 100% always. So I think I dealt with it better than most people would. Maybe that's kind of, like, I don't know, it feels kind of egotistical to say or something, but I really think other people in my situation probably would have dealt with it worse. Like, at least some of my friends that I know personally that have gone through similar stuff. And I still found it very hard. So that was kind of a long ramble, but I understand good. When people say, like, oh, you know, when, like, to keep yourself busy, like, the past month was probably, like, the hardest part, because this is, like, near the end. And when I first moved, it was, like, a big change for me and stuff like that. And I was pretty, like, sad the first couple days after I moved. But the thing about, like, keeping yourself busy is you kind of go on autopilot during those, like, depressive states. Like, you're not really thinking actively. You're not really, like, motivated to do anything. It's more so, like, I would have probably been even, like, fine just, like, doing manual labor for a couple days. Just, like, completely turning my brain off and just doing something, like, just to do something to keep yourself moving.
Mm-hmm.
I think during, like, the really dark periods, it's not so much about, like, being able to, like, improve at something or, like, get lost in something like that. It's more so about just keeping yourself, like, just not having an idle mind, essentially.
I think from the reaction I saw on social media and kind of across the various Discord channels, I mean, when you did very well in Dream League, I think it felt like that it was a great story and also a definite sense that it must have helped you a bit. Is that true? To know that you could do so well at a tournament with all this stuff going on, it must have made you feel there was some light in your personal life at the end of the tunnel.
Yeah. It was definitely a really happy period. My mom was able to watch all the games as well from, like,
that's nice.
She was still on a hospital bed in her place, so she hadn't moved to, like, hospice or anything yet. So she had the big TV in front of her, and she said it was nice to finally see me win something. You know, it was a really good time, but, like, it was immediately contrasted with the next month of, like, having to move and do all this, like, depressive stuff. So there was, like, a really big, like, you know, it's like kind of like jumping off a cliff to an extent. Like, you know, you felt like you feel like you're at the top of the world, and all of a sudden you just get pushed off a cliff. And you're like, oh, shit.
Yeah.
It definitely felt great, and it definitely motivated me to continue playing and to, it was nice to, like, finally prove to myself and then a bunch of people that probably didn't think I have it in me or something, like, you know, like, all those things, like, screw the haters, you know, I can do this. So it was definitely a very good feeling to have.
And I think as well, it proves, as you mentioned, that you had a couple of weeks before then when you weren't able to play, and then suddenly you were able to play for 3 weeks and you did this amazing run from nowhere. It proves that when you, as a player, get back to a point where you're able to concentrate on the game with the same intensity you were able to in the run-up to Dream League, that you will head back into the scene with a degree of ferocity. Is that something that you think about, or is it something that's...
Yeah, that's definitely the plan. You know, I was grinding really hard the couple weeks leading up to Dream League. I played, like, even before then, I tried to, like, keep up with the game a bit just by playing on an alt account or something, like, not so seriously, like, when I was kind of taking a break. But I was grinding, like, 1v1s, which I'd never really had that much time for. I was grinding the ladder every day. I was looking through replays. Like, I really spent, like, almost, like, my entire day every day on TOTA. I really showed.
What's the process like as a tier 2 player trying to break into the tier 1, kind of the tier 1.5 scene? Is it a process of just grinding the ladder, or is there a much more holistic steps you have to go through to becoming a top player?
I think when I was younger, and this is, like, you know, I'm getting older now, but, you know, I used to play Han, and back then I played maybe, like, 1,500 total games, and I started as, like, a complete noob who didn't even use the keyboard, like, use the mouse for everything. And then, like, 3 or 4 months later, after like 1,000 games, I was playing in like the pro in-houses. I didn't really join like a super pro team. It was almost always for fun because, you know, first place prize back then is like maybe like $10,000 for a dream hack or something. You know, it was really just like a hobby of mine. And I really enjoyed it. And then, you know, Dota 2 comes out with TI, and I was going through something else in my life at the time. Not necessarily like other people, like it's not like what it wasn't like, you know, someone in my life had cancer or someone was dying or something like that. This time it was more so like I was hitting the age where I had to decide, you know, college or what am I going to do with my life. You know, I'd love to play like video games or whatever, but Twitch wasn't really like that big then, I don't think. And then, you know, it didn't look too great, but like I really wanted to play. And then eventually I decided I do wanted to play, but it was a little later after that. But, you know, it was just a whole thing. I think I was in some weird middle generation where like the generation before me that played games played for like vent servers and t-shirts. And then mine was kind of in the middle. And now we have the people that like grow up watching TI, basically like they're 13, 14. They're like, oh, I'm going to play Dota and win $1 billion. I never really had that motivation as a player. I don't really, like even now, I don't really try to play for the money. It's just nice to be able to play and think like, oh, you can actually make a living out of this or like live comfortably at least. Or if you really make it, then like you're kind of set. It's just a nice thing to have in the back. So like you have something at least from playing. Like it's nice to always have a plan B, obviously, but it kind of feels more of a plan A even if you have the talent and the drive for it.
You play currently with a number of younger players as well, don't you? People who probably would have been closer to that generation where they can see any sport as a viable career. Do you notice a difference in mentality between yourself and them?
I don't know, because I feel like there's like this weird stigma in esports about age where I've noticed, like, you know, even just watching Counter-Strike, there's some older players in there, and that's probably more like reaction. Like, I don't know what people try to attribute to age as a factor as to why you can't play. I personally, like, my own viewpoint on it, which I haven't done much research in, and I'm not really, like, it's not really my field either. Like, I'm just a Dota player. Is I think over the years, you just, as you get older, you have other values outside of just playing, like, competitively in some way. That, like, you have other life factors. Like, maybe you want a family, or maybe you want, like, a really stable job. You don't want to just be living at home playing Dota all day with, like, not a stable paycheck. Like, there's these other factors that get in the way. Or, like, most people past the age of, like, 23, 24 have a full-time job. So I guess people try to think in that sense that, like, once you have a full-time job, obviously you can't play Dota and have a full-time job, I don't think, at the same time, or, like, any esport, really. So I think it's more so those factors, if anything, when it comes to age. I think some of the younger players, you know, with all their free time they get from being in high school, or like, you know, they get a lot of time to really focus and learn on whatever they want to do. And it can be like, I don't know. Cause I think there are a lot of young talented players out there that end up finding guidance from the older players. And then that's kind of why when they flourish. Because I've also seen quite a few, like, for every, like, what was Sumail, like, 15 when he came onto the scene? Like, for every, like, Sumail, or I think Brow was 16 when he started playing too, like, competitively it is. I think for every one of those that succeeds, there's, like, hundreds of them that, like, just don't find somebody from that notices them to, like, teach them some of the stuff that's a little more complicated, or, like, give them guidance in a way. I don't know. I think it's like, it's a pretty complicated subject, but I think young people definitely have an advantage where they, you know, they have more free time, if anything.
But generationally, do you think there's a mentality shift, as well as it being obviously the functional factors of free time and focus in terms of?
I think a lot of people from my generation and like onwards, I guess, like, you know, I'd say I'm in like the middle generation and then the later generation. I think most of them, at least in NA, have just quit because they didn't really, it's not that they didn't see a future in it. I think it was just like they got to the point in their life where all the other factors that I was talking about before, about just like having to get a job and stuff, got in the way. So it's hard for me to really contrast that. I think that a lot of the younger kids get into Dota because they like the game, not so much they want money. I think mentality, I don't know. I haven't talked to too many people about it, but I feel like the mentality hasn't shifted that much, but the kind of motivational factors are different. So, it's kind of like if you're like a young kid and you see like Michael Jordan or something on TV, and you know that if you get good enough at basketball, you're going to be good and you can care for your family or your like whatever in the future, you're going to be set. That's like way more motivating than just like, oh, I want to be really good at basketball because I want to beat this guy on the schoolyard court. I think the initial motivation of you like you loving the game basically, or like falling in love with the game is the same. But I think like the follow through is where the difference like comes basically.
Let's go back to Dream League somewhat. In that run, did it feel at all like a fluke, or did it feel very much like you were beating teams on your merit as a team? Or did you think you surprised people, perhaps?
This is like a kind of a tricky subject, because I'm the kind of person who really attributes a lot of it to like myself and what I had to bring to the table. And I think that like I was not a fan of the fact that like they told me they didn't play any games before the tournament and stuff like that. Like there are some factors that made it feel fluky. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, we're a team with zero practice. I came in at last minute. But I really think that like my own preparation that I was doing for, you know, they asked me like a week before the tournament, but I was playing nonstop like 2 weeks before. Like I had a good 3 weeks of like learning the patch and like really like grinding. I don't think that it was a fluke in the sense that there was no way we could do it again. But I think there were a lot of things that made our run easier. Or when I think of tournaments, I don't think the best team always wins. That's just like the nature of a tournament. You know, there's brackets, the way they can plan out. A best of one is a best of one. And then a best of three can become a best of one if you just win one game. And the other team wins one game. And I really think that like tournaments have never been the like pinnacle of finding out who's the best team at a time. It's more so about outsmarting your opponents when it comes down to it. So we had some good last picks, like with Lycan. I think my hero pool at that tournament had a lot to do with why we were winning. You know, when we were last picking Lycan, or we ran Viper a couple times, I don't think anyone else at the tournament was running a lot of these heroes that I was picking for myself. Or, you know, Caudle, CK, no one ran CK at the tournament, and I told our team to run CK. Or it might have been like more of a group thing, but when CK was suggested, I said it was just really good for us. Like, I was really adamant that we should just first two call CK every game, even stuff like that, where other teams just like, we didn't really define the meta, but we were doing stuff that other teams hadn't really had practice against and that really suited our play style. So there are these elements that made our run easier, where I think we still were one of the weaker teams at the tournament, even though we got second place, but we played the best we ever did individually at that tournament and as a team. And I think that like just draft and strategy wise, we were like doing really well. It was really something to like be in a lot of these games where it feels like our economy, like our team economy, is just like a third world country. Like we're down 20K golden experience every game. And then these guys come down knocking at our doors with tanks and we're just throwing rocks at them. Like, and then we just have a big comeback. But we played the team fights really well. So it's not just like a fluke in terms of drafting and stuff. I think a lot of things just went really well. The game we played, game three against NiP, where their Kunkka had like 40K net worth or something, we just had like a really good like strategy for how we wanted to play the fights. Like, it was communicated, like we discussed it in game before the fights, like if as long as we silence Shadow Demon and dual Kunkka, they can't win. So like we were able to do that four times in a row, and then their throne exploded. So we always kind of knew what we had to do to win, and sometimes executing that is hard, especially when you're down like 20K. But it can be that simple sometimes. Like, we shut down their only save, and then we kill their biggest hero, and then all of a sudden they're 30K net worth behind because their biggest hero's dead. You know, it's, I think the biggest reason we won that game, if anything, outside of that, is just the fact that we had perfect vision the whole game. I think we always had four wards up, and before every team fight, we always had vision of them. So, like, executing with vision when it comes to, like, silencing one particular hero and dueling one particular hero is all you really need. If we don't have vision, if they if they counted awards. I don't know how Juan even got such good vision that game, but if they counted awards and stuff, I'm pretty sure we just lose. I think it was more so like a wording battle, if anything, that helped us get back in that game. But we definitely outperformed everyone's expectations, our own expectations. I think maybe there's some fluky elements to it, but we're all really good Dota players. Like, we're all, you know, pretty high up on the ladder. We've played for a long time. It's not like we came out of nowhere and just, like, beat some players. It's like we play against a lot of these players on the ladder a lot, or we've played against them before, and they're not, like, some unbeatable monsters. We weren't against, like, the tier one teams, so we had a good shot at doing well. We, you know, succeeded, I guess. Yeah, we almost won the finals, too.
Yeah, very close. Did some of the teams feel somewhat rusty, maybe, after TI? Is there a sense of lethargy there?
I'm not sure if it was, like, rust or something. I definitely felt like people weren't drafting very well at the whole tournament. So I thought Nip drafted really well. Like, I really liked PPD's drafts that tournament, and I thought they were going to be our hardest opponent. I thought Liquid was not drafting too well, but they were playing really well. Like, it was this weird feeling where, like, I felt like we were getting outplayed, but our draft was really good. And then the way we beat them was basically just picking Lycan and stuff, and they had Anti-Mage. So I don't know. I think we definitely killed their run with some cheese. But even, like, Alliance in the Grand Finals, when they picked Kunkka, and I don't feel like they were good at utilizing that hero. Like, I didn't feel like it fit their strategy that much either. Like, I think teams were still trying to, like, they were new teams, some of them. Now, aside Liquid, Nip was pretty much brand new. Alliance was pretty much brand new. We didn't get a chance to play against the Russian team. And we played against JSTORM, but they weren't that new. They just had a new mid player or something, maybe a new offlane. They were kind of the same. I definitely felt that teams were still trying to put their stuff together. So we weren't necessarily that far behind when it came to, like, not having that much preparation. I feel like everyone was still trying to catch their groove. Think Liquid did much better in the recent qualifiers. I'm not sure. I didn't follow them too well, but
they've done, yeah, they've qualified very well recently.
Yeah.
In the NA scene, because you mentioned the number of NA teams there that you probably play with quite frequently, and NIP have moved back to NA more recently. Does it feel very insular as a community? Do you feel you know everyone much better than you think other scenes know each other?
I think for better and worse, that can happen. I think that, you know, we've had in-house leagues before, and they usually die because a couple people don't like each other. And, like, some people like each other, some people don't. There's just not a lot of people, and everyone does know each other. And that could be a good thing and a bad thing sometimes, but it definitely feels kind of like a tight community, but at the same time, sometimes it doesn't. Like I said, like, a lot of the top teams are usually not in the region most of the year, I feel like. The ladder can feel kind of empty, but yeah, I don't know. That's a kind of a hard question.
Do you think the influx of foreign talent has hurt the scene? Because teams like EG are close to entirely non-North American, and other teams are bringing in a lot, like JSTORM, for example, have a number of foreign players. Do you think that hurts the scene, or do you think it helps?
I don't think when it comes to that it hurts the scene, because some of our players go elsewhere too. I think the biggest thing that hurts the NA scene, if anything, is that there's just no, like, there's never any, like, NA LANs or NA tournaments, and I don't exactly know all the logistics behind all that, but I feel like there's just not much reason to stay in the region when, like, most teams have to travel to other regions to play the big LANs anyway. Like, we used to have TI here every year, and it's not really here. Like, last year was in China, this year it's going to be in Sweden. There just isn't much reason to be in NA. Like, I think other game scenes, like, I know, like, League of Legends, they usually have, like, really regional-based tournaments, so, like, I think most of their scene is based in LA or something for NA. There's just, like, more reason to have more teams and have players actually stay in NA than Dota, where I feel like I'm a real, like, not big fan of traveling. I think the reason that I didn't play so well the first day of Dream League, for instance, is just because the traveling was so miserable. Like, there's just one day of jet lag. I don't normally get jet lagged, but, like, when you do, it just really, you just feel, like, sick, kind of. Like, you just feel kind of out of it. And I think bringing in foreign talent and stuff, I think it's kind of whatever. I just don't see that as big of a problem as the other stuff I mentioned about just like there just not being much infrastructure or anything in NA for people to play. Even back in like 2012, like TI1, TI2, TI3, we had to play all our tournaments on European like server lag. Like we always had to play on ping, basically, like even for qualifiers for stuff. You know, the regions just never had much. And then that was probably the biggest, that's probably like the seed that like made people want to have EU players on their team all the time. Like I think at one point EG had a couple EU players back then, and then they decided to have an all NA team at some point because I think Fear wanted one. I don't remember. This is a long time ago, but some people want to have an NA only team, just, you know, fly the flag or whatever, but it's just not really convenient or practical a lot of the times either. Like, there's just going to be better players in other regions because there's more players available. We just have a small scene still.
Have you ever been tempted to move into a different scene? Because you played in Korea for a little while. And I know that didn't go sensationally, but do you think you'd want to do that again?
I'm willing to relocate now. I don't think I was able to the past couple of years or so, and I didn't really have much. I think I had one or two opportunities to, but they weren't very exciting anyway. But if I had like an opportunity to, I think I would. I really enjoy playing European pubs. Every time I go to EU, I just gain so much MMR that I feel like the games are much higher quality. Maybe not like better players and stuff, because I don't know, it's weird. I think the top players aren't that much better than the NA top players, but there's just more of them, so you get like more balanced games. It's like some weird just match quality, like not so much like, oh, EU is better than NA or something. It's just like I think they have 200 AK players or something. We have like 40. So like there's just more high quality games, and it's just much more enjoyable to play with other good players. I don't know about the Southeast Asian or Chinese region that much, but I would be willing to, you know, go to other regions if given the opportunity. It's not like I'm stuck on being in NA or something.
That's a close one I've got for you, actually. We've had a new patch recently. How are you finding adjusting to it? Has it been difficult with queues being what they are?
Oh, you mean, yeah. I mean, my internet's been down for like almost like a week and a half now. So I've played here and there. Like they tried to fix it the first time, and then I've tried to play a couple games and it just crashes all the time. They're sending someone in on Friday now when the last person I sent was on Sunday that didn't really do much. But from watching other people's streams, it just sucks to see, like, there's like two sides of the coin. You get people complaining all day about, oh, we have divines in our games, oh, we have ancients in our games. And then they're like, oh, now our queue times are too long. I feel like ever since ranked roles were added in like summertime or something now, it's just been on and off broken. Like it was okay for a while, but I don't think I could have queued Dota for like a month straight. Like it was like worse than what it is now. Yeah. I think only offlane players could find games basically.
Do you think with such a huge patch that requires a relearning of the game, that's actually a problem for the competitive scene? Because I remember Seb telling me, for example, that he thinks the best way to adapt to a patch is just massively pub for ages till you find all the weird.
Yeah, I think it is a big problem. I mean, even with this patch, like for the qualifiers, I think Valve wanted to push the qualifiers back a week or something, I heard. But then a lot of the teams had flights and stuff booked and like boot camps booked, so like they couldn't. Was like the situation. And I think the qualifiers had really low quality Dota because no one had, like, all people only had like 3 or 4 days to really like play the patch. But pubs are probably the best way of learning your, like, practicing your individual skill, like laning, hero matchups, even, or, you know, farming patterns, like stuff like that. Playing against, like, in a team environment is definitely much different. It feels like a whole different game. But as far as, like, just learning how strong heroes are or, like, learning patch changes, you're going to be able to put more volume into pubs versus, like, there's a lot of downtime from scrims. Like, you have to schedule a scrim. You can't play anything, like, 30 minutes up until the scrim because your game's not going to be over yet. Like, there's all these like factors that make it so you just put way more volume by hitting Q over and over again. People can play like 16 or 18 games in like a 13 hour period streaming. So you're just never going to get that anywhere else. So it definitely is the best way. And it sucks that, you know, people are queuing for 3 hours and not even finding a game.
Do you like the new patch? Do you think it's exciting or are you worried?
I was initially skeptical of some of the changes. Personally, the neutral items didn't bother me as much as it seemed to bother like Reddit and some other people. I found that like a lot of the items, even like after I've played the patch, they just don't really do much, you know? You're not really getting to 70 minutes and seeing some of the really broken items. So most games I played end in like 30 minutes, and that's like tier 2 items still, sometimes tier 3 items. And most of the time, I just have to throw all these junk items out of my inventory into my support's inventory. So I don't think that's a really big thing. I actually enjoy the fact that there's some other objective on the map after 70 minutes, because the biggest problem Dota had ever since talents were added, ever since 7.00, is that it kind of offset the balance Golden Experience had. So, like, you know, being level 20 versus 25, like, before talents really wasn't a big deal. So, like, if you died pushing their base, but you got, like, the full set of Raxes, it would usually be worth it. And then all of a sudden, if you gave them, like, 4 or 5 levels from a team fight, especially, like, supports would gain more in a late game team fight, they have talents that are like almost worth more than gold sometimes. Like some of their talents can just be like, you know, Winter Wyvern's 25 AOE stun on the Splinter Blast. Like that, there's just no amount of gold in the game that would be like able to overcome what you just like gave up by trying to push. And games were just really hard to end because experience became so valuable that you could just sit in the base. And I think a good step was putting in the 70-minute neutral items, because I don't know, maybe even the, like they should put 90-minute ones that are just like something like you just end the game or something if you collect all 5 of these items. Like there should be incentive to leave the base after 70 minutes. A lot of the long drawn out Dota games have just been teams sitting in the base because that's all they can do and the other team can't push. So I think that's positive. As far as the outposts go, I miss the side shop. I don't know how I feel about them. I think they sped up the game a lot, because before, I feel like my understanding of last patch was that at around 20 to 25 minutes, around like BKB timings, everyone would just sit at Roche the rest of the game and have a Mexican standoff. And then the winner of, like, some games would last even like 70 minutes, just no one got a Roche yet. Like, there'd just be that much of a stalemate. But that'd be like the objective. Everyone farms in order to like team fight at that time, and then that would kind of decide the game, because there's shrines, there's buybacks. With the shrines being so close to Roche, even if you had full map control, like you got all the tier twos, they could still contest Roche, so there wasn't much reason to try and run over people early. But I think this patch with the outposts, there's like something to fight for even earlier, so games just got sped up a lot. I'm not sure I like how snowbally it is. Like, most of my games are like 20 to 30 minutes long, and I'm not really getting any of these long games. I don't think I've had a single game where I've hit level 30 or gotten a tier 4 item, let alone a tier 5 item. So I kind of miss some of the longer games, but not too much. Like, I don't want to play a 3-hour game against techies or something. But and then the other change, what was it? I'm kind of forgetting, but there's another big change. The couriers. I think the couriers, I thought it was going to be different than it was. I think a lot of people are playing Nature's Prophet and Bounty Hunter day one of the patch, or day two, because the couriers are so slow level one. It's such a weird feeling being a mid player, and your courier just doesn't get there at the same time as normal. Like, I'll start getting low on health and I'll buy a salve and I just can't lane for like a whole wave because the salve's just walking over to me still or something. It's just that was kind of the weirdest patch part of the patch for me, is just the courier speed. I think overall it's about the same as before. Like, Dota never really changes that drastically, even with all these big changes. It's still Dota. But the meta will shift in a way where I just think the games are really stompy, and I'm not necessarily a big fan of that. I liked last patch a lot. Like the playstyle of like the 20 to 30 minute constant fighting. And then before then, it's just people trying to make good decisions and out efficiency their opponents in certain ways. There were games where you could steamroll and win by 20 minutes even. But I thought that there was a lot of... I thought that the game's really exciting, but it did get stale, I guess, for a lot of people after a while. That's usually how Dota patches go.
Okay, I think that's all I've got for you. So what's coming up next when the team's decided? Are there qualifiers that you're looking to play or online tournaments?
I guess the next set of qualifiers will be after the major, so it's kind of a long ways from now. But personally, right now, I'm just trying to focus on streaming, which was going really well for about a week, and then my internet stopped working, so... That was great.
Do you enjoy the process of streaming?
I've always enjoyed streaming for fun. This time around, I have more of like a, not necessarily business focus, but I'm definitely more focused on trying to make money out of it because I have to sustain myself more now that I'm out on my own, which was going great. I got like 100 subs in a week. I was offering coaching that was going really well. There are some kind souls out in my community that were also trying to just help me out because of my personal situation that donated like quite a bit of money. I don't know. I've always found that playing pubs all day can be pretty lonely, especially solo queue. And streaming was just a way to like, you know, at least be a little social while you play. I think I come mostly from an era where at least duo queue was like the standard. So like you'd always be like at least chatting with a friend or something while you play. Like, I don't know. I found solo queue to be really grueling and like kind of like it's like too much solitude to just play like 14 hours of solo queue every day or something. I used to play like MMO games and stuff too when I was younger. And just having like the group experience, like everyone just sitting on a server, I guess it would be Discord now, and just, you know, chatting it up while they're doing whatever, or, you know, you play a ranked game or something together. I think that experience is generally what people look for in games. I felt for a long time that solo queue was kind of hindering like Dota's growth, just because like it was my grief with StarCraft 2 when it came out, where I just felt like I was playing a single player game. Like I really enjoyed StarCraft 2, and I really liked playing RTS games like when I was growing up, and I like really enjoyed StarCraft 2, but then I would load into a game and the only thing people say, because everyone's really polite in StarCraft 2, which is a good thing, is they say good luck and then GG at the end. You just feel like you're playing bots the whole time. Like it might as well just be a robot. There's like no interaction with anybody. You have to go out of your way to find forums or something to talk to people about the game. I just really don't like the whole like solitary process. I really loved Battle.net on Warcraft 3. I felt like it was much more of a social experience, especially for Dota, where you had to find lobbies.
Yeah.
I don't know. I think there probably could be some other way to do it. I think that matchmaking might just be like kind of fundamentally flawed, but I could be wrong.
Okay. We'll leave it there then. Is there anything you'd like to bring up or plug yourself just to close up?
I guess I'll plug my stream, twitch.tv/iannihilate. Might be a little hard to spell, but I'm sure
I'll link
it
in there.
Yeah.
I've spelt it like four different ways when prepping for this.
I've always been told my name was bad. When I was like 13, I had an iPod next to me, and a Rampage in Han was an Annihilation. I was like, you know what? That's my name now. And I can't hate on 13-year-old me, so I don't like the people that just change their name all the time. I feel like that's lame. I think if you just pick a name, you're stuck with it, you know? Yeah. But I have really considered just changing to my real-life name, because that's what people generally call me anyway. They just call me Danny. Give my stream or like when I'm playing, so I don't know, we'll see. But yeah, I just plug my stream. I have a Twitter as well. It's twitter.com/iannihilatedota. That's really about it.
Thank you for listening to the Position 6 podcast, and a huge thanks to iannihilate for appearing on it. I want to thank him firstly for opening up so much to me. I really appreciated hearing about his story, and I hope that he'll come through what must be quite dark times and very well, and come out the other end as a better person, and a better player, and see a lot of success in the future, whatever happens. Thank you once again for all of your support so far. Again, if you want to follow me on Twitter, I can be found at Danny Loffen, and that's spelled Daniel and an OFFEN. And please do let me know there if you've got any feedback or comments about the way I produce these shows. Again, if you want to financially support the show because you think it's an endeavour that's worth supporting and paying for, you can find a link to my Patreon in the episode description. As a part of this, I'd like to thank several of my most favourite supporters. Firstly, Christopher Strong, and then Jarpadox, then Paradox State and the wonderful laser light displays, and then Mark Wernell. So thanks guys for all of your support, as well as everyone else who supports. Next week, I'm not sure who I'm going to be on. This was recorded a couple of weeks ago, so I may have recorded a new episode by then. But it should be someone good. The new year is always an interesting time for people, kind of rebirth and all of that. So there should be a couple of people that I'll be able to invite on in advance of the major. So look forward to that. But until then, though, thanks again for listening, and I'll see you next week. Ha ha ha.